Mohit is an expert at leading businesses and organization transformation strategy, execution, and large change management initiatives using processes, technology, and analytics. With Mohit, I would also like to invite Nimit Arora, who is the supply planning lead at Sterlite Tech. Welcome.
Thank you. So first of all, obviously, thanks, Akhilesh, for showing us the latest technology trends. And thanks, Vikas, to show us the whole SAP product portfolio that you have across manufacturing, operate, deliver, design. I think that's really great. Whenever I come to these technology kind of events, conferences, I really get excited. And that's not about food. So what really excites me is that all of this technology which is being talked about, I mean, a lot of times people say this might come in 2 years, this might come in 3 years, or it might come in 5 years, 7 years, but it has to come. I mean, obviously the world is changing. So a lot of these things, like Akhilesh mentioned, like 10 years back, it didn't exist. I mean, things are very different. So I'm sure the 10 year hence would be very different. And what really excites me is that the company where I come from, which is Sterlite, is actually powering a lot of it. And I would just want to kind of have a raise of hands on how many of you know about Sterlite technology and technologies and what it does. So just a quick show of hands on who knows about Sterlite. Of course, GitaCloud does. I mean, we have been working with them very closely, some of you. So I think it's a great kind of platform to also kind of show you what Sterlite technology does. A great company to invest in, and that's my personal view, just a disclaimer. So I would be playing a quick kind of a corporate snapshot of what Sterlite is. Then I'll take you through what our transformation journey has looked like so far, how we are approaching transformation, how did we set up a roadmap, what are the different things that we are doing as part of transformation. And then my colleague Nimit will actually take you in specific about integrated business planning. We have recently deployed the response. I mean, we'll talk about how the IBP journey has been at Sterlite. And I think we'll be happy to kind of take any specific questions that you might have. But it's been really a great journey. So something to definitely look forward to. So. We'll talk about Sterlite, what transformers do in Sterlite, and IBP. Can you just play the video?
We are creating the future. A future being built on smarter networks. Changing the way we live. Because what is good for humankind is good for us. We design, build, and manage smarter networks. Networks capable of serving billions of endpoints with near zero latency, with the agility to adapt in real time, and which never sleep. Which is why 8 out of the top 10 global telco service providers rely on hyperscale modern networks delivered by us. And our market presence spans over 100 countries globally. Develop customized network solutions for global cloud companies. We create world-class communication networks to help secure national borders. Also leverage the power of technology to enable hyperscale digital inclusion and smart living. Our unique FTTX mantra solution helps our customers create integrated networks that connect millions of homes and enterprises. Our ingenious products are the world's best known medium to carry high-speed data. With cutting-edge cutting-edge manufacturing facilities across the world, we are all set to become one of the top three integrated fiber providers globally. Our unique iCore approach to network design helps build smarter networks that cater to every digital need. Our comprehensive Lead 360 approach ensures faster network readiness by optimizing total cost of ownership for CSPs. Our intelligent software solutions are driving digital reinvention, simpler and faster, helping you make smarter business decisions. Our research and development centers are working to build solutions that are customized to meet your needs. Come, witness the future of smarter networks at our world-class experience zone. We encourage an inclusive, open, and diverse culture because happier workplaces make happier employees who deliver better ideas. We strive to give back to the communities that we work with. We do our bit to keep our environmental impact as neutral as possible.
Connectivity solutions where we manufacture optical fibers and fiber cables, which is a very patent driven process, very kind of highly technology oriented process, and we obviously own a lot of patents in India and across the world. So that's been our flagship business. We also work in network services, so we deploy a lot of networks that you guys use on a daily basis. So whether it is Reliance Jio, Airtel, Vodafone, Idea, and even a lot of BharatNet or smart cities like Jaipur, Kakinada, Gandhinagar have been done by us. And obviously we give a network software to run these solutions on your phone. So a lot of billing softwares and the softwares of the future, which is the programmable and disintegrated networks, is kind of given by us. So those are the three business lines that we have, and of course we have a lot of innovative culture within Sterlite, and that's what we kind of stand for. Obviously you saw about 8 of the top 10 telecom companies across the world being our customers. Then cloud companies, we are working with Google, we are working with Amazon, we work with most of the other cloud companies that you kind of know about, people who have data centers, people who have any kinds of like telecom networks. In India, we obviously work with Indian Navy, we work with Indian Army. We did about more than 10,000 kilometers of fiber deployment in Jammu and Kashmir. We are setting up an integrated network for the Indian Navy all across India. So those are some of the kind of very proud applications that we have already done or we are in the process of doing. We work on the citizen networks. You talked about the Gram Panchayats, connecting more than 250,000 Gram Panchayats on broadband in India, and of course the large enterprises. So this is just a quick overview of the countries that we give our fiber to, and pretty much it's everywhere across the world. So just coming back to then transformation, how do we drive such scale, because we are a very, very agile company. I mean, a lot of things change very quickly in the telecom domain. So I belong to the transformation team at Sterlite, and we had set up ourselves a kind of a 3-year roadmap, which is what I'm going to kind of show you. Of course, this is something that we kind of keep in a very agile format. We keep changing the things that we have to do and bring in new things or retire some old things. So we had set up a 3-year roadmap, including fixing some of the very foundational and structural aspects, because when you are actually building up a transformational roadmap, of course, you need your base to be very strong. So things like master data management, or things like having people trained on basic program management and stuff like that, are very foundational in nature. So we invested a lot of money to make sure that our foundation was strong, so that we could build on a lot of scalable and repeatable pieces. And of course, we're working on certain moonshots, and some of them actually are now coming into more scalable pieces as well. So a lot of technologies which Akhilesh talked about, like RPA, IoT, edge devices, all of these things is something that we are already kind of doing as part of our operations in India. And these three pillars of foundational, structural, scalable, repeatable, and aspirational moonshot is being executed with four distinct teams. So we obviously have the technology behind all of this. The technology is aided through all the processes that we have, the repeatable and scalable processes. And the data, which is, we're creating data lakes and stuff like that. So kind of ingesting all the data, giving the right signals to our planners, to our executors, to our managers. So that's our analytics team. And of course, the people. So these are the four key kind of teams that fulfill our roadmap. And we built our roadmap in a very, it's kind of a very interesting Lego block model. So we said that these are some of the things that we kind of build up, and that's how we kind of create digital transformation at Sterlite. So any questions on how you set up a roadmap on transformation, how do you execute transformation, which projects to do first, how do you make your management to agree on the business cases that you want to do on transformation, please do come and speak to me or email me as you wish, and I'll come back. So that's about transformation. One of the key parts and pillars of this transformation is integrated business planning. So we obviously set up the teams, we set up the processes for integrated business planning, and now we have also gone live with SAP IBP's demand planning suite, so S&OP, and we have recently gone live with the response planning as well in our factories, and my colleague Nimit will be taking you through the details of that. And we have even gone ahead with the production planning, so the exact machine level, minute to minute planning. So that's what we have also gone live with. So that's where you see the tick marks coming in. So just a quick brief on why we selected SAP IBP. Of course, we were a SAP driven company. We were on ECC, so we that obviously fitted our solutions better. It's obviously self-serve dashboards, web-based planning, a lot of things that we were talking about earlier. Were a part of SAP IBP solution, so we obviously picked up this solution, and the availability of consultants and OEM support. So that was our product selection criteria. We worked very closely with GitaCloud team. The team is sitting here today. Of course, we went through a good number of vendors to select them. So their proposal, their engagement, their willingness to work with us on a day-to-day basis, being owners, not just vendors, actually kind of excited us, and that's the reason we chose GitaCloud. So now that, in a year's time, we have already gone live with all the aspects of SAP IBP. So Nimit, yeah. Over to you.
Thank you, Mohit. Good evening, everyone. So before I run through the demo, I'll just continue with what Mohit said. So basically, if we talk 2 years back, we were doing normal planning as the small companies do. Then we were at a very small level, and then we were also expanding and we wanted to grow. So we looked at certain things and we said that we want single version of truth, because everybody in the plant was planning. Be it finance had their own numbers, production had their own numbers, SCM had their own numbers. We wanted one version of truth. So just then we started transformation, and with the transformation coming in, we set up the process first. That was the S&OP process. We first set up the process. It took about 1 year for to establish that particular process and getting everybody on board on how to plan. Once we had that process set up, then we went into IBP. Then we thought about getting in, getting the software to, so as to ease our life and to minimize a lot of nuances that might happen that with the Excels or the normal manual work. So I'll be covering through with this demo. I'll be covering through the solution architecture. What are the advantages and the process flow? Advantages we have listed after we have gone live with response. These are the advantages that have come. So starting with the end-to-end architecture. So basically, there are a lot of inputs which are there. We had a lot of different models. We had Salesforce. We had, since we are a cable company, we had our own software cable builder, then we had SAP ERP. So there were different systems working in a different domain. We got them all together to get the IBP response and supply as well as the IBP demand. So if you look at look here, you'll find all these blue, these are the inputs and the output that we get, which goes back to the sales team as a response in terms of delivery. So there are a lot of things that we have done. Once I'll go through, you'll get to know. It looks like a complicated slide, but once we go through, you'll be able to relate to it. Talking about the advantages, that's one thing which everyone wants to see when we're talking about implementing a software and what are the results that we're going to get. So the best part that happened with us was manual intervention got reduced like anything. Initially what people used to do, they used to change, we were working on Excel, so they used to change the numbers. And those numbers, we got to know about those numbers once it either goes on production level, and that then we get to know that this number has been changed, and then firefighting starts in the plant. Now that manual intervention has been stopped by means reduced by 75%, and any kind of intervention that happens throughout the chain, everybody knows that this change has been made. So we are not waiting for people to recognize that change, to identify that some change has been made. So it goes throughout the chain. So that's one good thing which has happened. The second is a lot of man hours got reduced. There were a lot of people who were extracting data just to get the reports, the day-to-day reports. And we are now utilizing those people to for data analytics and to even strengthen the process, the SNOP or IBP process that we follow. I think Akhilesh was talking about the top management getting the data. So this, with this, we are getting seamless information flow right from shop floor guy to the top management. And even the top management can drill down to the shop floor wherein they can see what is happening on the machine if they want to. They have a particular dashboard that they see, and if they want to, they can even get, deep dive and look at the information and be able to get the decisions, build up the decisions. And even with this, we got a very clear understanding of our constraints. Being a manufacturing industry, the biggest constraints are capacity and the RM. The SCM teams, they are always firefighting, they are always running around to get materials. With this, with IBP, we got two different type of scenarios, wherein we built in one scenario, which is the finite material scenario as well, wherein we built MITs, we built the stocks, and accordingly we made a plan. So that had helped them a lot. We have now recently we have built the revenue as well. We have done the revenue integration with the volumes we were planning earlier. So now we are able to work through on what is the revenue at risk be it on demand side or on certain capabilities of the machines. So that revenue at risk can be found out. Even we have automated the, it's not just about the production plan, it's more about giving an end-to-end solution. So when we are getting a delivery forecast, we have to go back to the account manager or the sales person, giving them the end result, that is the delivery date, so that they can map and accordingly pitch into the customer. So right from getting a delivery forecast to making a production plan to a dispatch plan, realizing it into sales, and then finally when the delivery will happen, this is a continuous process. This is a simple chain, and we finish it off and close the loop. And talking about the simulation, I think Akhilesh was talking about simulation. So here the best part is we used to invest a lot of time in the new RFQs that come, and we used to get everybody in, all the CFT teams in, whether be it design, be it SCM, be it production guy, PPC guys, so that we can discuss the RFQ and respond it back to the customer. Now with IBP coming in, we just simulate, send the results to everybody, and ask them to give a go ahead, and just it's done on a click of a button. Rather getting everybody on board and asking them, please come, there is a new RFQ which has come and we have to respond, this is the time. So that latency has been reduced. So on the demo, I'll start with, I have used most of the dashboards from IBP itself. So you'll be, while I go through, you'll be seeing all these dashboards that are coming in directly from IBP. So we have a demand planning process wherein the demand comes from the account manager, then it's vetted by the regional head, and a consensus demand planning happening, which gives us two different versions. One is the booking forecast and one is the delivery forecast. Both of them being essential for the production planning and dispatch planning. So with the booking forecast coming in, we even drill it down to a level wherein we get, since we are a industry of cables, so we have a lot of families within those cables. So micro cables, say duct cables, or micro module cables, a lot of families. So we drill down to the families wherein that helps us identify what is the identify and relate to what are the capacities that are available. So all the all the demand that comes in is all on a granular level, and it directly comes in from the account managers with a consensus vetting. So these are the drill downs. This is the demand that comes in. You can drill it down to any level. You can drill it down to a family level. You can drill it down to a regional level, material level, or any other vertical that you want to, that you have in your portfolio. Then once the demand comes in, first thing that we do is we phase that demand. We phase that demand back to the ex-works, because that's a delivery forecast. And while we're planning for production, we need a date where we have to ex-works that particular demand. We have to move it out from the plant. So we phase it out based on the lead times. And that is not done manually now. That is done through IBP. Once it is phased out, we get this ex-works demand in our system. After the ex-works demand is there, this is just an example. So we have divided our demand into four categories. One is booked. Booked is some orders which are released in the system. Then there are certain POs which are in hand. The third category being the long-term service agreements. And the fourth is the projected demand. So now what happens, this particular exercise happens somewhere around, the demand planning exercise happens somewhere around 15th and goes till 20th of the month. So within those 5 days or even beyond, whatever new POs that come into the system, how will the system identify those POs and convert them into either PO in hand or a released forecast for us? So this is a customized logic that we did with GitaCloud, and that is called forecast consumption. So as soon as the demand, this is a snapshot which is there while the demand is demand forecast is being made, and once after say 5 days or 7 days the demand comes to the plant, and till that time that PO, some of the PO has come, it automatically removes that forecast from the category, from the projected category, and moves it to PO in hand. So this is how they identify on a material level, even on a material level, so that the numbers are same and we know exactly where our demand lies. So this is the second thing that we do, that is forecast consumption. And once the forecast consumption is done, then we prioritize the demand. So based on the four categories that I talked about, we prioritize all the demand. There can be different categories which can be made. This is a customized logic. You can just build in categories how you want to define. So even if I'm showing here a category called book or a released category, someday a person can come and ask me, what about CAM customers? Right. So within this, I can build a CAM customer category just before this, and accordingly, everything flows. So the prioritization is done based on the rules that we put in. This is how it looks when we get into. So booked is all 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, based on the category. Then category 2 PO in hand is 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 3, 2, 3, and that's how it plans, that's how it flows. So now once this is done, the main thing, production plan. Production plan, we can make a production plan based on the constraints, that's very easy. But here we get two things. One is two different type of production plans. One is finite capacity in finite material, and a finite capacity, finite material. So finite capacity, finite material is what we have built in all the product lead time, all the RM lead times and everything in the system, and it will calculate the FCFM. This is an easier way to go for SCM team, but when we look at the profitability or the usage of lines, the capacity utilization, then this is the plan that we work on, FCIM. Both the plans, we compare, the delta comes in, and that is where, that is the only thing that SCM team has to focus on, and not the complete set of orders that are there. So this gives us a very good thing wherein we balance our capacity utilization as well as the RMs. So this is just an example of when the demand is higher than capacity and the demand is lower than capacity. How does it show? So it basically balances everything on Incoterms and opening stocks, and postponement is done. If I have a higher demand in a particular month and I don't have capacities, it just postpones it to the next month, and we have a very clear visibility on which demands are postponed, and is there any way that we can, what are the constraints that are coming in, and is there any way that we can bring in those demands, so that the decision is easier for us. So this is how it looks. This is a capacity view of all the lines that are there. We have different stages in our manufacturing capability. So just an example of one of these stage getting constrained. It's 100% booked. So the other stages, maybe they don't have, they might have the capacity, but we still cannot make. Then we leverage out what are the other products or the other families that we can produce directly without using this stage, that we can produce directly, and that's how we go back to sales and say, bring us extra demand in this particular family. So this gives us a very clear view. And the same is when the demand is less than capacity, then the revenue integration, it shows, it clearly gives us the opportunity loss that we can have based on the unfulfilled capacity. And FCI model, basically the, in this case, it actually pulls the orders from the next month. So like here, if you see all these, even on the stage wise, it's showing there is no 100%. So we can pull different kind of orders from the next months. Looking at, I was talking about the delta between FCIM and FCFM on RM thing. So this is just an example wherein on FCIM we see that we see the requirement here is approximately 12,000, wherein on FCFM it's just coming 5,000. So the SCM team can look at the delta directly, that they have to bring 7,000, they have to only work on 7,000. 5,000 is already coming, they have to work on 7,000, and that's how they give us the 100% capacity utilization. Also, we have some, I said we have reduced 75% of manual intervention, not the 100%. So there are still some pockets where we keep the manual intervention. Something like we have built in this demand management in SAP directly, wherein there are certain, there might be certain customers who have released the order, where the orders are released, but due to some changes that they have, they might want us to stop those orders for a particular, for a while, so that so we just work on this particular system. We either push them through, we make them planning irrelevant, and that's how it doesn't plan and it doesn't show up in the planning scenarios. And this is basically a manual intervention of pulling in or pushing out the demands. This is a generation of dispatch, delivery and sales, which I have talked about earlier as well. And the simulation that we were talking about. Anytime a new demand comes in, we can just simulate, we can just put it there, run the app and see whether that demand fits in or not. If it doesn't, what will be the end date? And that's how we communicate back to the customer. And the response time is very high, very low rather. It's very low. We don't have to wait for all the departments to come in and meet together. That is it from my side. Any questions?
Yeah, first of all, thank you to Mohit and you for the such a great presentation. It was really interesting kind of thing. I have two, three questions. If time permits, we can cover. Otherwise, we can meet over the outside the thing. First of all, I'm sure the company like Sterlite or the STL, which is a huge organization, and you must be having a detailed process before you finalize any major solution. So although we are sitting in a SAP's event, but I will take this liberty to ask you, whenever we talk about a planning kind of scenario, typically this business planning kind of thing, there are two major players which comes into picture. Whether it is a Oracle EPM, Hyperion kind of solution, or now it is a SAP IBP, earlier it was a BPC or IP. So what are the other products you evaluated before finalizing? One is a natural solution. Most of us are the SAP shops, so let's go with the SAP. That's the normal or natural path people follow. But I'm sure you must have evaluated before going to that. Second is, how was the UI? Because in my previous organization, we have used SAP IBP with the BPC combination or the BCS combination. So UI was a terrible kind of thing, although it was implemented with the multiple raw materials running into thousands of things and multiple SBUs. Entering the data, I mean, it was a Herculean task. So with the theory in picture, how do you find the UI? So these are the two questions. The rest I will take it off.
So maybe I can take one of the questions, and maybe Nimit can take the UI question. We have some of our SAP colleagues sitting here, so of course. So I mean, that's a great question. That I mean, they're not just two. I mean, Oracle is there, O9 is there. But of course, before we took IBP, I mean, we saw some demos pretty much from a lot of these product companies. We kind of did whatever we knew, but it's just not feasible to go to the nth level of detail. So we did two things. One, obviously, we kind of took a leap of faith, because that's very important. Otherwise, you kind of get stuck in a very analysis paralysis kind of a thing. I mean, I know companies which have spent about 2, 3, 4 years just deciding on a solution. So in today's world where obviously you need a lot of agility, you need to decide fast. So that one is a leap of faith. Of course, discussing with the colleagues, like you are asking this question to us, we kind of obviously asked multiple people, we took some customer references and things like that. So that's basically one. And the second, of course, was on how quickly we can kind of integrate it in our own environment. And SAP IBP obviously comes with inbuilt. You asked about data entry and all of that. So a lot of those things also we are kind of integrating. So for example, our Salesforce is now integrated with IBP. So whatever the demands or forecasts which are coming into Salesforce are automatically getting pushed into IBP. So there's we are kind of avoiding duplicate data entries and things like that. And even talked about focus consumption as one of the logic. So that also avoids duplicate data entries, because whatever, if you get a PO, then it's not up to the account manager to kind of go and remove the numbers in this row and put it. It automatically gets consumed. So some of those things can be done. And now IBP has also moved to web-based planning. So from an account manager point of view, of course, it is becoming a bit easier. I personally don't use the UI, so maybe you can comment on that. But of course, with the web-based planning, it has pretty much an Excel UI. I think Excel is one of the very kind of easy tools to kind of use. So that way, with the integrations in place, with kind of some customized logic in place, and with the Excel UI and web-based planning, I think it's fairly decent, I would say. And the overview?
Normally what we see in the plans, people are working on Excel, so it's very easy for them to understand what they want to do. Not even in plans, it's actually for the sales team as well. They have been working on Excel, so that's the easier way they have. So with the IBP coming in the same format, it's easier for them to adjust to what needs to be done.
And typically on the financial planning side, that is still underway.
So that's still underway. We have just recently done the revenue integration. We'll be getting into the gross margins, gross margin calculations, profitability, and everything. That within a course of time, say approximately a month or so, we'll be just completing. So that once that is done, then we get into a business planning mode. Since it's quarter three, we'll be getting into a business planning mode, and then all the calculations come together.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Mohit, just wanted one thing. I saw the place where your factories are there and where you are supplying your material. So in supply chain, one aspect is where do you produce and where do you supply? How do you optimize that particular thing, reduce the cost and maximize your profit? So we have, of course, seen in your presentation that a lot of manual work of collecting order and then processing at the back end, that you have converted into automated system. What about this optimization of complete supply chain from source plant to the end customer? Has that also been done, or is that still under process? No.
So I'll just answer. Basically, we started with demand planning. There are different modules in IBP. One is demand planning, the other is response, and the third is supply. So we started all this with one of our factories. We started with demand planning. We then went on to response planning. And we have completed that particular, the whole cycle of that particular factory. We have factories at different locations. We have factories at different locations, and soon we'll be getting into incorporating this demand and response in all those factories. Once we have that, then we get into the supply model. And on the decisions, like you said, wherein we can decide on which factory to produce and how fast it can be. So we are on that. We are in a phase of just implementing it on a factory-to-factory basis.
The one we have done does about 70-80% of our volumes. But that's a very good question. And we are also kind of growing inorganically. We recently did an acquisition in Italy, Metallurgica Bresciana. We are looking at other countries as well. So supply planning becomes very important. The optimize of where to make is very important, as Nimit said. So the response helps you to optimize from a factory, and then the supply actually helps you optimize the network. So that's the next stage. So we're kind of taking it step by step.
How quickly you would complete this first
stage? So demand planning, I think one other thing from the early question I forgot to mention, that we also did a initial 2 month kind of a just an initial study where we built a POC. So we started about July of last year, and today we are in September. And we already have response planning is already live for about a couple of months now. So within like 10 to 12 months, we have gone live with the SNOP demand planning, we have gone live with the response planning, and we have also gone live with the production planning. So production planning is the minutest level of details of every machine, every product. So these three key modules we have been able to do within 12 months.
Nimit, I have a question. You said about RFQ.
Yeah.
So how your software will helpful for this RFQ process?
So basically, it's all the RFQs currently are not coming directly into the system, but when we do the simulation, we just blend in the data in the system and we do the simulation. Say an RFQ has come for a particular from a particular customer for a particular material and a quantity. On this screen, this simulation screen, we just enter those that data and run it, and we get the final output on whether it can be produced as per the customer demand or it's being pushed out, pulled in, whatever is the result. We are also looking ahead on getting the RFQs directly coming in from the SAPC system to the simulation model. The only challenge that we faced on getting that directly was the design capability. So the sales guys who are putting in the RFQs, they were not aware, they are actually not aware about the design details. So there is a separate design team which comes in, which sits in the plant. So RFQ comes, the design team works on the design, then they give us the input, and accordingly we can simulate.
So we basically work on a JIT principle, and pretty much all RFQs, if you put today's date and run a simulation, you would know how soon you can make it, because it'll start to plan it and make it with the current available capacity.
But if I have different requirement, like if I want to procure some machines, machinery, and kind of machines that will be changing. I don't know in future what kind of machines I need. So in that kind of scenario, how your software will be?
So, well, it's not our software, it's SAP. So I think I'll just say that, see, some of the things with Nimish mentioned, so there are certain designs of cables that we know we manufacture. But every time RFQ comes, it could have certain elements that we don't know. So there, that's where our design team comes in, and they kind of say that, are we capable of making a particular design of a cable, right? So this is just a hypothetical question on new machinery. So one I would say is you need, what we are doing this kind of a response planning on a 3-month cycle, on a weekly bucket level. But if you look at a long-term forecast on a long-term capacity planning, you could also use a system, and we are kind of putting in now forecast for up to 2 years to create a visibility. So when you are having those kind of things, it actually gives you a capacity constraint at a much higher level, or certain designs which will require, let's say, a new machinery and things like that, which then you can plan because you have data that is available to you to do that planning. A lot of times, I mean, companies work a lot in dark or just based on their own tribal knowledge in terms of what they think is going to come. But this kind of helps you do a long range capacity planning as well with the data.
Question which I need to ask. This integrated business planning definitely takes. The integrated business planning definitely takes into account the plant issues, like planning for the winters, spare parts, or something like that. Okay, I'm coming from one recent issue which we faced. One of the plant critical machines conked off because there was a card which was not available. Okay, so we could locate that card not with the supplier, but one of the manufacturers in the US, suppliers in the US. Okay, by some kind of a person knew somebody in the US, and we could locate that, and we could get those. Does this particular system have a capability to talk with the different systems, like say Oracle, SAP, within amongst themselves, so that this integration could help to locate critical parts across the globe?
So maybe I'll just answer. So these kind of situations happen in every manufacturing. So see, my view is that it's a IT system, and in today's world, I think I have a lot of my IT colleagues sitting. You can make any integration possible. So there is no limits to the kind of integration you can do. You just need to be conversant with what kind of an architecture you're creating, and how, I mean, you could have, let's say, strategic sourcing, where you could, let's say, have suppliers who tell you what kind of things that they can provide. See, it's not a magic wand, obviously. I mean, there is a lot of effort which goes in. I mean, Nimit, he's the key planner in our whole system, so he does a lot of those planning things as well. But from an integration point of view, you can make any integrations. But the system being able to find a card which is not available at a particular OEM, and I don't know. Maybe any inputs from you? That's probably similar to his Aldo experience, where he didn't get the shoe size.
Right. This would definitely mean modeling those parts wherever they could be available. In S/4HANA, we have the advanced ATP functionality, right? So that, what it does is, it goes across locations, across suppliers, and it could check for the availability of that part. But it assumes that you have modeled that. I mean, without giving an input to the system, it cannot intelligently determine where to source it from. But when we talk about S/4HANA, is integrated to IBP. So when we do a planning, and do an availability check whether a particular machine would be available to plan or not, it would look at some of those things, and that could be modeled. Going across systems, I would say the data has to be transformed to IBP. You know, it's very native to SAP. So SAP to SAP data, very native, right? But transformation of data might be required across systems. But advanced ATP is something that will help you get there.
Hi, I'm Abhishek and I'm from Suzma. Actually, my question is based on certain assumptions. I'm assuming that you would also be a project-based company. You would be executing projects of, say, optical fiber installation. So there's a challenge that we face with, say, our company, where we try to map revenues of our projects to our contract structure. But when you are trying to integrate your revenue, integrate revenue with your business plan, I'm assuming you would come across same challenges because you would be executing projects across the globe. They will have their own contract structure, their own milestone payment structures. We also face similar challenges. So while trying to automate and cycle, as of now, I mean, we rely on a lot of manual entry as far as contractual structure or mapping milestone payment structure in our system is concerned. Any insights on how you have been able to overcome these things? Or any specialized tool that you have used, maybe say RPA or OCRO, or any other thing that you may have used? Any insights on that would be welcome.
So, a very interesting question. So, as I said, we work in three business lines. So obviously, we do manufacturing, we do the network services, and that's where your question is on the deployments of the network and kind of how do we do it. So, we went out in the market. I mean, when I showed the whole transformation block that we did, I know there were a lot of boxes and you might not have been able to see through everyone, but there was a box on a service execution platform. So we a couple of years back, we went out in the market and we were trying to find a solution which helps us do exactly what you're saying. And we were not able to find a one solution. So what we did is we kind of combined best of the breed solution out from the market and we kind of combined it ourselves. And that's what we call as a service execution platform, for which actually we have also applied for a patent now. So that kind of helps you do everything. It helps you do a process workflow. It helps you do the project planning. It helps you do the project management. It helps you do the, it shows you the visibility around how your projects are running at various sites, where are the invoices, where are the customer orders, and all of those things in a single dashboard. So all of that we kind of built in-house, and obviously that has improved our capability to deliver our projects by multifold. But that's something that we did in-house, of course, kind of leveraging a lot of platforms available in the market. So happy to talk maybe offline on that, but that's something that we have been able to solve as well. Okay, maybe, do we have time for one more question?
One last one.
Okay.
Am I audible?
I think what you said when you started with the journey for IDP, so you said there was a base that you wanted to make. So how difficult was it to get the MDM and the users to build this data and get it up and running? Once you have this, it's a seamless kind of work. But how was your journey in collecting that and ensuring that that was right to the last team.
Absolutely amazing question, because IBP just cannot work without a very good MDM in place. It'll just be a constant battle on a daily basis if you don't have a right master data. So that's the reason MDM was part of the foundational block that we actually attacked first before we even thought about, we thought about doing integrated business planning, but we solved that first. But of course, the IBP has acted as a kind of a forcing mechanism to get the MDM in place, because every time I get a chance or my team gets a chance, we talk to the management and everybody about the importance of maintaining a good hygiene on the master data, whether it is lead times, whether it is material masters, whether it is the speeds of the machines on which it kind of works. All of those kind of the detail, the kind of the nth level of detail that we have gone in the master data, it took a lot of effort, but we were able to prove again and again to people with a constant messaging that without master data, integrated business planning is just going to fail. So with that constant input and obviously a top-down drive towards maintaining a very good master data, I think we are at about, I would say about 98-99% there. There are still kind of loopholes where we kind of fall in because somebody did not update the master or something kind of got lost. But I think it has improved. I mean, it kind of, we leapfrogged from 0 to 50% quickly, but the journey from 50 to 100% has taken an extra bit of time, but we kind of definitely, we remained invested into creating that whole master data management kind of a frame. And we had our program manager just drive the master data side of it.
And the second question, just a quick one, actually, did you realize the kind of KPIs that you set in for this project? Like, you know, your reduction in, you know, cycle times or reduction in, you know, your costs. And you know your ability to increase your capacity.
Yeah.
What you started out and what you ended up at.
So in fact, I mean, what we started off with, we were able to kind of nearly beat those things. So initially, when we started off, we said we will improve our capacities by nearly about 20%, and that will kind of impact directly the bottom lines of the company by kind of, or the top lines actually, by having more revenue. But I think even 20% was probably a smaller target to take, I would say. I think the kind of visibility it gives you, the time it frees up from your regular planners, the better job that they are able to do, the master data that kind of comes in, and all of those kind of pieces where you are able to see how your capacity is getting utilized, what kind of orders should I bring from the market, what kind of orders should I not bring from the market, your order to delivery timelines, all of that has kind of drastically improved. And so our one KPI which we took top down was the capacity creation, which we have been able to build. But Nimit, you have any more inputs on that?
So basically, that was the one thing which everybody looked at in the plant, on how you can create the capacity using the planning. And just before we started, as I said, we first started with implementing the process, and then we got into IBP. Just when we were working on the process, the S&OP process within the organization, we increased quite a bit. And with IBP coming in and the visibility, visibility being clear, it's almost approximately 30% that we have gone through. So that's a huge number.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for being very interactive. I think I actually love to.